right, we'll call the meeting to order at 7:05. Absent is Jan Warner. She could not be here this evening. And Patty Kavanaugh, business manager, also is not present this evening. First order of business to review and approve minutes of October 6, 2016. So I need a motion that we approve. I guess it was only Ashley and myself there.
Yeah.
Frontier meeting?
Right, because Phil was in the other meeting. So can you make a motion?
Make a motion.
I have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Why abstain?
You know, there's debate about that. At the
Really?
Collaborative, they say you don't need to be present to approve minutes.
Okay, I approve the minutes then.
So, okay.
So Elaine seconded?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Financial statements?
There are eight warrants today for a total of $45,092.49. Plus the cafeteria bill, which I was just handed for $3,377.03. So that's a total of eight warrants.
Okay. And any financial updates? Budgetary, what? Patty sent them to, sent it to us. I don't know if anybody had any questions about what she sent to us or if all looked good.
Later on in the meeting, we'll talk about the budget timeline.
Okay.
But other than that, oh, and then she sent those, right?
Right.
I know in her note that went with that, she said, "This shows what this financial information shows."
What we voted to use.
What we voted, but she didn't list what we voted to use, and I couldn't remember exactly what we voted to, so I was sort of at a loss to sort of.
Reserved funds?
It was taking, she was taking some money out of wings, and do you remember to pay part of the salary for the physical therapist? There was some discussion in the committee about that.
It was money out of the spend revolving?
Yeah.
Right.
Which is not, yeah.
You understood, in that sense, do you?
Yes.
Okay.
I think that was all that we.
Still my post-election fog, sorry.
Yeah.
I just heard that.
Yes. So anything else in the financial statements that we had a question about?
Yeah, I think you can see it right here.
The revolving fund.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Now, there was nothing that we needed to do about contributing to the move?
Money.
Money to, for the move?
We, the regional, the Frontier Regional voted to use the excess and the E&amp;D, the excess and deficiency from the Frontier Regional account, so that was taken care of.
It's going to be on the town. We do know, and I, the part of this, the longer, we do know that part of what, there was some money in an account for the renovation of the central office. But because it was already approved by the four towns.
Yep.
But it was sitting there and it hadn't been spent. But because it was specifically voted by the four towns for that specific thing, we have to go back to the four towns and say, we now need to use the money for this.
Yeah.
So it's going to be like we're asking for permission to use money that's already been deducted and whatever. So it won't affect the taxpayers at all, other than if.
Marking it for a different use.
Right.
So the money was specifically earmarked for 219 Christian Lane, and because of that, we need to change it to 113 North Pleasant Street, South Deerfield. And that is, I think it's about maybe, I think there's $30,000 in that account that won't be used at Christian Lane any longer. But we're asking for that money for air conditioning, so it will go on the town warrants, and that money will come to us in the spring, just for the offices that work year-round to put mini splits in those offices.
Yeah.
The E&amp;D is $28,000 out of I think it was $103,000 from end of fiscal year 15. There's going to be more money from end of year 16, which will be certified. It probably is. The accountants were in our office this whole week. So we're asking for a very small piece of that for the phone system, which is about $28,000. Mm-hmm. And the representatives from each town on the Frontier Regional Committee voted to allow us to use that. Mm-hmm. So
waiting on the town's vote, each town vote is fine.
Well,
because
it's going
we
to
don't
be
need
separate.
Air conditioning before then anyway.
No, we're not going to worry about the air conditioning.
Okay.
Before that.
It's going to be a separate article in the warrant.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
There's no public, so there's no public comment. Unfinished business, discussion items, vote on a new start time for Conway School Committee meetings. What time was proposed?
6 o'clock.
Six.
But there was reluctance to act in your absence.
It's tough for me.
So,
I coach basketball, which goes till 7, but I don't want to keep people out too late. I mean, I could probably manage it once a month, but.
How long is the season?
March.
All of the other committees have changed to 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
And, it's.
People are just a little more alert, probably.
And, of course, I have 5 of them.
Yeah.
But that's okay, because I'm here to do that. That's my
right.
job, and
yeah.
I don't mind one bit.
Yeah. Can you all make 6? I know Jan can.
I can make 6.
All right, I won't hold us back.
It's not that. It's, it's you shouldn't be coerced into...
It's fine.
Peer pressure is a terrible thing.
It's all right. I can
we
handle
teach
it.
Kids if to stand up to peer pressure.
If I couldn't do it, I would say, but I can try to manage it, so...
And if it's really a burden, if it's really a hardship, we'll open it up
bring
for discussion.
Back.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Bring it back.
All right.
Thank you.
Yep. So do we need a vote on
yes,
that?
Yes, we do.
Can I have a motion?
Sure. To change the start time till 6 o'clock.
Okay.
And so we'll
starting December meeting.
Actually, 7 first.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And so we'll meet in the library if that's okay with folks, because our after-school program is sort of
right.
winding up.
Still
right.
at 6?
Yeah, I think our last pickups are 5:30, 20
okay.
and 6, and by the time Jerry cleans the room.
Yeah.
There might still be Legos on the floor.
I thought there was an issue with videotaping in the library.
Is there? Oh. Can we give it, are you going to be with us
no.
in December?
Oh, just about.
Well, that's why we moved here. I preferred the library.
Yeah,
it seats way better.
Way better.
What was the issue
the first
in the
one
library?
The meeting I went to was in the library, and,
yeah.
it was filmed.
I thought it was about the taping. Good, let's
you
go back to the library.
In December?
You can call Chris about that, and he might be able to help Gab out with that. I mean, I don't know what it is, so.
Okay.
Okay.
You can email us and go from there, yeah.
Yep. The library's cozy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Alrighty, new business. Discussion items, 2016-17 school improvement plan.
All right, okay, so in your packet, take the third page in. We have a great school council. Jeremy is our kindergarten teacher. Sarah Carlin is a co-chair. Amelia Leonardi, Katrina, Niels and Jennifer Wheeler was a first grade teacher, and we created a school improvement plan, talked to the staff about it, and now we're bringing it forward for your first glance and hopefully approval at the next. You should have 2 readings of it. I think that's the way it goes, and so at the next meeting approval. But as you can see, our areas of focus are student achievement, safety on the back, diversity and public relations and parent collaboration. We thought those were the 4 big areas of focus. Students at Conway Grammar School are typically high performing students, but that doesn't mean that student achievement shouldn't always be first and a top priority, and so that's why I put it there.
What about social emotional learning, which seemed to be the whole thing of?
Yeah, so we already have, we have in place Second Step, which is a social emotional curriculum. So we talked about putting this in the proof improvement thing, but it wasn't anything different, it wasn't anything new. Mm-hmm. It probably has been in the school improvement plan. But I'm happy to put it back in if we want to.
Do you think it's well enough integrated versus just like a class that they have to do?
Well, I'll tell you, that's a really good question. And so when I first came on board, it looked like it was really well integrated, and teachers were using the vocabulary and doing things to for STAR behavior. But now that I'm talking to kids a lot and hearing some of the, you know, I do think the kids need more work in terms of putting it into play.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we worked on the school improvement plan for the first month and a half. Mm-hmm. And to be honest with you, I didn't have that information then.
Yeah.
But it's a good point, Elaine. I think that you can give a program, and the teachers are using the language and pushing it. But out on the playground, out on the soccer field, I'm not sure how well it's being transferred.
Some of my basketball players swear like truck drivers. Yeah. It's like, whoa.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, kind of took me back a little bit. I was like,
yeah.
You're in elementary school.
You know, I've talked to a couple parents on a couple things, and they, well, yeah, at soccer, they're very competitive, or they're very this, or they're very that. So, you know, I think that's a good point, that how are we going to, we're talking the talk, and how are we going to help the kids walk the walk? So
mm-hmm.
I'm happy to put it back in. I mean, my first thought was Second Step is here. It is.
Right.
But it's using those skills on the playground and on the soccer field or at the basketball court.
One thing I found, too, is
dance.
When we do the lessons, if we really role play, if we do role playing during the lessons, instead of, you know, just even having a basic discussion, you know, send kids off in pairs and say, okay, show, you know, this half of the class, show me how, you know, what does bullying look like, you know, develop a scenario where someone's being bullied and the other person's the victim, and then this half, you know, you show us what bullying looks like and somebody is, you know, how, you know, not interfering, but someone is stopping that bullying behavior. They're using the words, you know, I feel badly when you do that. I need you to stop. I need you to stop.
If we can bring our new First Lady out to, you know, help us with that.
Yeah.
It's going to be her mission, is anti-bullying.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's
might
a
start
great,
it in the White House. But,
it's a great, it's a great point, Lynn, and our kids are spot on with the role playing and knowing what STAR behavior is, and they are spot on. It's just like when you learn spelling words, right? Incorporating them into your writing. That's
right.
So, but yeah, continuing the role play. And
I agree with you, Kirsten. Ways of generalizing it into the less structured areas like recess, and that's a universal elementary school issue.
Yeah.
You know, it's taught as a curriculum in the classroom.
Yes.
And then what makes it more naturally presenting organic in other school settings.
Yeah.
I'm also curious, what would an anti-bullying committee look like? What would its function be? How much discussion is that?
So, I think that we should have an anti-bullying committee so that when we do have, you know, obviously bullying is very, very serious. So that when we, first of all, the policy, the procedure, really tighten those up, the paperwork that goes along with it, the real definitions of what, mm-hmm. and I know it's all out there and the state has given us the language,
mm-hmm.
but some of it is sort of cumbersome, so really simplifying it,
right.
Really a committee to hold us accountable to make sure that we're doing what we need to do when a bullying incident comes about,
mm-hmm.
you know. Too often, not necessarily, but just in general, we say, oh, that was just an incident or whatever, but no, it really is bullying, and let's look at the definition, let's make sure our paperwork is filled out, and let's make mm-hmm. sure we're giving the victim the protection he or she needs, you know, a safety plan or whatever that is. And I'm not sure that we go that far, really.
Right.
So I'd like a committee to sort of hold our feet to the fire and make sure that we're doing those things.
It sounds like more assurance and integrity.
I wonder whether there's, I mean, do you have a sense whether the issue in the past has been a difficulty in defining when bullying is taking place, or has it also been a, I don't know what you want to say, but I don't, difficulty is not the right word, but when there actually is that conduct, that is what to do with it when it's there, when it's...
You mean like teaching the other kid that's being bullied
The entire range of responses is to the bullier and the bullied and et cetera. I mean, is that where we've fallen short of in the past, as opposed to figuring out what bullying is and isn't?
Mm-hmm.
Or
bullying to me is sort of like the hot thing right now. And some of it I think is just normal kid behavior, but bullying to me is, the definition is like repeated,
yes,
sort of over a span of time,
yes,
and not, you know,
making
a mistake. That's where parents get a little mixed up, I think,
it
and
also,
that's where kids
it also
mixed
has
up.
To, well, it doesn't have to, but it also includes an imbalance of power. So someone is powerless and somebody has more power in that interaction.
Right.
Part of the issue is, you know, you have something that comes up in September and you take care of that issue and, you don't necessarily really document it well because it was a kid issue and you talk to parents and you talk to kids and then something comes up in December and you don't have that documentation from September because it doesn't have to be repeated in terms of week 1, 2, 3, you know what I mean?
Because they can go underground for a while.
Right. And so I think you're right, actually. I think we can't, you know, we don't want to get out of control with bullying. But it does exist, and we just want to make sure that we're handling it right. And you know, the bullying, in terms of the person, the child who's doing the bullying, we have to remember it's not about punishment. It's about getting the kid the help that he or she needs to, A, they don't feel good about themselves for whatever reason. So that's where I think sometimes parents get afraid when they hear bullying, because it's not about punishing the child who's doing the bullying. It's about, okay, let's look at this child and figure out why they're bullying. But you're right, we have kid incidents all the time. I heard an interesting conversation today that's what talking to kids and stuff, but we're coming back from running group and there were these two kids on the playground and they were acting really silly. They're just being silly, fun, you know, silly. And one of the boys walking said to the other girl, "I've never seen them like that. What's there? That's funny. They're having a lot of fun." And I heard the other girl say to him, "You won't see them like that, but I have." He said, "Well, what do you mean by that?" He said, They can't act that way in our class. They can't act that way because that's just not a way they can act." And not talking about the teacher, she said the dynamic of the class. And I thought, how interesting is it that these personalities that I hadn't really seen before either. They were kind of giddy and silly and they're very contained in school. And I thought, how interesting was that? Because I was wondering if the child was going to say, "The teacher, you can't act that way." That would have been. But the child specifically said the dynamic in the class, they could never act that way.
Yeah, these guys that are together for like the whole journey,
so they
get put into their little positions.
Yeah, I was really glad that I heard that. But it made me realize that we do have to do more work.
Mm-hmm.
I think kids here are very happy, but you know, I do think that they get into their roles and it's something we have to pay attention to.
So I mean, it could probably just be solved by putting like
a couple of bullets
about social emotional learning
or something. We'll bring that back in December.
And the other thing I was wondering, and I don't know if it belongs in this or not, is we've talked for a long time about STEM stuff and how we can get it into the integrated into the curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if there's a plan for it or if this would be a plan for it or...
Right, so that's another good point. We stayed away from it a little bit because they just came out with the new science standards and I think the teachers are still trying to wrap their heads around what they are and what they And it has been in the school improvement plan, I think, for a couple of years.
Well, a group of parents that I have talked with for years now, probably going on 3 years, 2 or 3 years, are very, have really tried to bring it forward, have done presentations to the school committee, have, you know, one is, it's what he does in another school.
Yeah, he wants to come do some robotics,
He has, you know, offered to get donations from Lego and, you know, fund it and whatever. And then it just keeps, you know.
Yeah.
And they're really frustrated that it just, you know, because kids seem to really enjoy it, and especially the kids that are more hands-on really benefit from it, but all kids really benefit from it. So it's just, I just hear always about.
So that's a great thing to add, and we are doing more and more, the first graders are doing BeBots. Has Harper talked about that?
I don't get a lot of information.
It's the neatest thing. So our older kids are doing coding, but the little kids are doing BeBots, and it's really neat. I've been able to see a few lessons. And so they have their little beetle bugs, and they program them. They have to try to figure out how many steps forward, how many steps to the right, and how many steps to the left they're going to get to their spot, their food or whatever. And the kids program it. It's really neat to watch them. Jennifer will take them through and say, okay, are we short? No, we're too short. How many? Well, I think 2 more steps. It's really great to see. So I think it's there, but making it formal, I think is it.
Okay.
And we are going to have him come in to do some robotic stuff.
He's been dying to. I think when he talked to Maggie about doing it in the fifth grade. But. Yeah.
I also know in kindergarten, Jeremy made maple syrup like boxes, kits, that really explain to the kids, and he's made them for every kindergarten teacher across the district because they worked together in the summer from the Hitchcock Center. They actually developed a curriculum, a new science STEM curriculum with the help of the Hitchcock Center. They came in June and worked with the teachers for several days. But just to tell you quickly, so this box, you're a teacher, you get a box, there's a piece of wood, like a piece of a tree. It's already drilled out, and it has the spigot and the different pail and everything you need to understand and see how maple syruping works. It's very, maybe on the way out we can look at Jeremy's room because they were right lined up in his room. It, really nice kits, and he made one for every teacher in the union. Which,
cool.
You know, I just love it when teachers collaborate like that. It was very, very cool.
That's awesome.
So yeah, those are great ideas, and we'll add those in. Okay.
Can I just ask one question?
Sure.
We sort of got rid of Spanish, and we're supposed to be doing like Russian. Russia is I don't get a lot of info from my kids, but I don't know if that's in the higher grades or if it's going on in the lower grades or if the teachers have so much to do, which it seems like.
Yeah, we had a meeting, and then we're going to have another meeting again. So we've been really lucky that quite a few artists, I'm using that word loosely, have contacted me for the Cultural Council grant and different things. Eshu, do you know
Eshu?
Pretty big grant to come in and do some work with us, and I wish I brought the list of people who we're getting grants from, and I will once everything's solidified. And so with the 250th celebration, Conway celebration coming up, and the Historic Society coming in and doing more work with the kids and using the little schoolhouse, the staff was thinking, because they hadn't started anything in Russian, they didn't have a plan. Wouldn't it be neat this year to focus on Conway, in the history of Conway, because everything is going to be, the 250th celebration, kids they're going to do floats, and they're going to do dances, and they're going to do things. Eshu can incorporate it into his work. The Historic Society has applied for a grant, but I said to them, even if they don't get a grant, I will find the money, because the work that they're going to do with the kids around Conway is really great. So, I think the teachers are going to want to go that route because they feel like then it's all combined, more it's local. Coordinated. We need to get a better handle on the language thing. It felt to me like it was, I think there was great intention, I'm not trying to put anything, but there was no plan, it was hodgepodge together. And teachers are spending so much time on their math, science, social, and reading curriculum. It was one more curriculum we were going to ask them to do, and one more prep that we took away from them when Spanish went away. So the teachers here have four preps a week, where many schools have five preps a week. So they were not complaining in the least, but it just seemed to make sense until we got our, I don't want to say got our act together, but got our plan together around language.
Mm-hmm. Now, are we thinking of hiring another Spanish teacher, or?
You know, Elaine, I don't know. I know it was cut out, and I don't know what happened to the money or what the decision was. I'm not sure what the history behind it was.
I don't remember that either. I thought she retired and we were replacing her.
They decided that it wasn't of value.
Who decided?
I remember being
that would have been
that.
Us, wasn't it?
Yeah,
I wouldn't have decided that since someone.
They wanted to replace it with a world language and SAMP whatever. And
I don't remember that conversation.
I don't remember the discussion about whether to rehire or not. I mean, that would have been a hopey thing to talk about.
Right.
Yeah.
I just thought the person retired and they were trying to fill it and couldn't.
Yeah. I mean, the individual, you know, there was a professional, and it's not a realistic expectation for teachers to incorporate teaching language into their curriculums, yeah. Right? So.
Right, it was a one-shot, yeah. Very
right.
Brief deal.
Yeah.
She was coming in anyway, once a week to
mm-hmm.
each class or
mm-hmm.
something for.
Is it worth it? I don't know. I mean, a needs assessment. I mean, we have our own particular interests about language being taught in school,
mm-hmm.
What do the rest of the teachers think, what do the families feel,
mm-hmm.
What is the priority as a community,
mm-hmm.
You know. I don't know how much that went into the decision or not to not rehire,
mm-hmm.
But is that something that should be done to, I don't know.
Do you know if the other elementary schools have a language
there? Well, we shared her with Whately.
Oh.
So I'm sure Whately lost.
Mm-hmm.
It also, I don't know.
She was 4 days a week counselor at Whately, and she came here to teach Spanish for one day.
Oh, she was a counselor at Whately? So
she
they
was
did just
an adjustment counselor.
So she wasn't doing Spanish there.
I thought she was.
Was she here for half a day?
Yeah.
It was half a day in each building.
Yeah,
oh.
Yep.
I think that's what it was.
Oh.
So it was a unique arrangement for many years.
Exactly,
and it stopped.
And
so.
What they did in Whately to replace that position was they hired one person to be the school adjustment counselor and the school psychologist.
Yeah.
So they did not replace Spanish.
Right.
And because that Spanish piece was part of your piece, it didn't
mm-hmm.
it didn't happen. However, in Whately they have the garden program. So 8 months out of the school year, they have a special that is gardening.
Mm.
And they have an outdoor classroom and they plant the gardens and they do a lot of learning around planting and growing.
Mm.
So, and that's,
mm-hmm.
So they already had five.
Yeah, the teachers aren't complaining about that. So I don't want
yeah.
anyone to think
no.
that.
Yeah.
It was just felt like we were another.
I mean, I like the helping get ready for the 250.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
That's
I mean, I
this
just,
year.
It's kind of two different things.
Yeah.
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 I mean, that's a great use of the time this
mm-hmm.
year. Just are we going to think about a language or should we do, you know, Survey Monkey survey of the school or something to see what people think? Or I don't know.
It's one of those things that people,
it
might,
was
not
so limited
people,
anyway.
People might not always think favorably of things that are good for them and their kids, like foreign language.
Right.
Like so, especially nowadays.
Yeah.
Especially if you say you want to teach Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
But,
yeah.
But I want to teach Spanish. I think it's a good thing. And
it just was
yeah.
such a limited way. I'm actually not sure the kids.
I mean, that's
that
was what we would talk
week.
About, whether to that limited extent. Can, And that's always the problem with the small schools and the after school and everything.
It was.
Can you get good at anything if you do it an hour a week?
Yeah. Right. It was a little bit of vocabulary and some cultural education and some singing.
Yeah.
Right.
I'm kind of sure that's what it was.
You're right.
Mm-hmm. You know, I mean.
Well, maybe we can think about it going forward.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you don't want to vote tonight on the school improvement plan?
No, I'll add to it and bring it back to you.
Great. All right. And the FY18 budget calendar. So exciting.
Okay.
There's actually 3 signatures on them all already.
Oh, okay.
Thank you very much. So, does everyone have a copy of the budget calendar?
I don't believe so.
Not printed out.
You have my email.
Do you want me to go make copies?
Oh, I brought my iPad, but I can't find the email. Yes, I do. Yeah, I know who she is. Yeah. And, she has two young, she has two beautiful kids. I see her at Conway.
Sure, she's
going
to make some copies.
Does she have what?
Yeah, I just know.
Sorry about that.
I know.
I brought my iPad specifically to punch up the attachment. I can't.
We're trying to be paperless, but if you look from this
and I just noticed
to this
that,
end.
There's a lot of trees here.
Yeah.
Cool.
He's having somebody. So we have yours.
1-year-old.
That's for you. That's for
Principal of
Gordon.
No, what's that road?
Yeah, yeah.
This person's book.
So what I first house on the right.
All right.
Oh, wow.
So what I just handed out in this paper is just something for us to think about, and we're going to vote on it in December.
Okay.
And you can see that there's 3 columns. It took me a while to figure it out in Sunderland's moving, but I got it down to a science now. This is data to talk about. We're not voting tonight. I just want you to be thinking about it and be exposed to it. There's 3 columns, and the first one is fiscal year 15, fiscal year, the second is fiscal, 14, 15, and 16. That's where we are now, 14, 15, and 16. And you can see on the top line, thank you, how all the lunch prices have stayed the same. Oh, we moved down, we're not on the budget right now, we're on this proposal. So the lunch prices have stayed the same over the last 3 years. And so if you look closer, you can see the reimbursements and the paid lunch price, the reduced lunch price, and the free lunch price. What happens is, if you look down on the other shaded one, the bottom one, that is the reimbursement we get for every free lunch that we have, that we supply to students. So in 2014, we got $2.65 for every free lunch. In 2016 or 15, we got $2.70. Mm-hmm. And this year we're getting $2.78 back for every free lunch. We're being reimbursed. The problem is, by law, we cannot charge our paying students less than what the federal government is reimbursing us for free lunch. So we're 3 cents off already. So the request that we were asking you to think about is upping the school lunch cost by a dime to $2.85. And hopefully that will bring us through the next 3 to 4 years that we don't have to change the price again. If we brought it up 3 cents, next year we have to go up again, and it go up again. And then we thought, well, $2.75 if we just go the quarter and go to $3, but that might be a hardship for some families. So we thought if we just went up 10 cents, that's 50 cents a week, and that would cover us, and it would cover us for several, hopefully three to four years.
I wish the United States Post Office would do that. I hate when they just raise it 2 cents or whatever. Just raise me a nickel.
I know. And
get it over with.
So we'll talk more about this next week, next month, and Patty will be here and she'll, you know, go into it again. But this really tells you what the costs are to us and what we're being reimbursed for our reduced lunch, our free lunch, and our paid lunch. This school is excellent. Their cafeteria services are excellent because we're not losing any money here. And the food quality is great, the lunches are well received, and it's wonderful. And we can tell you that if you have any children at Frontier, we're really working hard over there to really improve what's going on. And Darius and I have really put our heads together with Deb, and we're trying. So
your efforts have been noted, by the way.
Really?
Yes, they have been.
Thanks.
It is actually, I heard excited teenagers talking about it in the car, bringing it up amongst themselves.
Well, thank you. I'm so pleased.
You should be.
Thank you.
Should be.
Well, Deb, you know, Darius gets a ton of credit because, you know, and he and I met, and then we put things together, and I brought some ideas back from my previous position, and Deb's been, you know, pretty responsive. So we're excited, and more things are coming. I'm looking now for a freezer, any kind of chest freezer, so that we can sell ice cream novelties that are okay by the federal guidelines. Is everything we sell has to be, but I think the kids would really enjoy, you know, something like that. But nice. Anyhow, we're talking over here at this school.
Is it for you?
Yeah. Oh, really? Let me know. You know where I live.
Months, in a month or so.
Okay. So,
ice cream makes the world
great. I'll tell you, this is to be discussed next month, but I really wanted you to be exposed to it now. It's something we probably need to do, and we have to do it everywhere across the district, mm-hmm. but we wanted to bring it up. So, now we can look at our budget calendar. Thank you. These are the dates that, actually, we took this from FY17, which was last year's, and we just adjusted the dates to add, you know, 1 or 2 days. So it's essentially the same. The reason why March 16 says at 6 or 7, 7 or 6 is because if we're changing all our meetings to 6 o'clock, then we would, you know, have this, you know, deliberation at 6 or, you know.
Yep.
Tomorrow we're meeting with Principal Gordon at Central Office at 9 o'clock, mm-hmm. first thing in the morning. And we're going to be discussing things and, you know, what we, you know, just to start with the budget and the different positions and stuff. And I would suggest to you, if you want to add a one day, I don't know how you would find a one day a week Spanish teacher, but there must be somebody out there that, you know. But it'd be worth, you know, mentioning, you know, I mean, we can look at that and, you know, we can add it, and if the budget looks too high, we can take it out. But, you know, if you want to suggest that, or if you want to wait until you survey people, or so the first week in December, the second week in December, we are going to meet again to look over, you know, refining the budget, and then again the following week we will meet again. And just, you know, the first meeting tomorrow is really looking at people. That's about 80% of our budget, looking at the positions and the cost and what we can predict for next year. We're making cover sheets so that the committee members, the school committee members, will see what they have, what we have for faculty now, in what areas, and who's doing what, and the, you know, the enrollment by, you know, who's you know, how many students, how many special ed students, how many this kind of thing, and then our projected for next year. Who do we project? You know, how many teachers in what area do we project, and students that we're projecting. And it's a little bit easier now because we have a little bit better idea because of pre-K. But kindy's always kind of hard, you know, it's a moving target. So we're working on that. We'll be working on that tomorrow, and then the following week we'll be looking at materials, supplies, and other additional things, and we'll be ready to present the budget to you in January. We're hoping that you know, we'll have a complete package for you, and you deliberate. The committee deliberates on it and look at it again in February, and then we go to the town, the selectmen, the town committee, the finance committee.
When do we traditionally invite the, which month do we invite the finance committee here? Is that February?
February or March, it must be February.
So then are these current dates of school committee meetings, or are these additional dates?
No, these are the current dates. These are the current dates. I will tell you, and you know, Frontier added some other dates to ensure that they are really having enough time. They have a budget subcommittee, and they've added dates. We can add or change any of these dates. That's what we're doing tonight. If you want more or less, or you want to change, we can change it at any time. We just need to post them, so we need to know. And then I would say on March 16th, we have a public hearing. We have the public hearing. We could start it at 6 and then, you know, vote after. I think Sunderland was toying with the idea of separating the hearing from the vote, because you have the hearing and then, you know, sometime you can't go back and really change things up too much. It might, you know, maybe to separate the two things, but it's traditionally been done this way. You have the hearing, the public hearing, and then the vote, and it gets on the budget or the town ballot.
Okay. Any other questions regarding the schedule?
You know, I would recommend to that we invite the finance committee, as we've always done, except for one year where Marty went to them.
Yeah.
But okay. The past 2 years they've come here, that they've come back here.
Yeah. How was that when the
last year they came?
How did that go?
It works here.
Yeah.
It works here because the finance committee, the gentleman that has a particular interest historically in the school is actually knowledgeable in you know,
ask good questions.
Yes, yeah, and ask good questions and sort of and what and that's definitely, we're really lucky in this town to have like a finance, knowledgeable finance committee member about schools. So, mm-hmm.
What I was wondering is when Marty went to the finance committee and the town board. Was it better to have them come here and talk to us? Okay, thank you. So Phil requested that we invite the town finance committee or town selectmen?
Both.
Finance.
Both. The selectmen have come here occasionally.
And what day do you want them to come?
I would check with Jan, but my recollection is they come in February.
February.
Okay. Thank you.
And so I think we always, so I guess we do split that. We do have a hearing. Do we vote? We don't vote it in February. We vote it in March.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we vote it in March.
So I think we've always sort of organically split it. There. So there you go.
Okay, great. So in February, and I'll circle February. Right, and 6 o'clock. Thank you.
All right, so we're going to postpone the vote on the school improvement plan until we get it updated. Mm-hmm. So we're on to reports. I would just like, it looks like it's in Lynn's report too, but three of us attended the school committee conference on the Cape. I thought, I had never been, even though I've been on school committee for a decade, but I thought it was well worthwhile. I really did. First of all, spending time with fellow school committee members was great. And just some of the workshops, they need bigger rooms, which was kind of annoying.
Every workshop.
You couldn't get a seat and it was very, you know, just you're on top of it.
Claustrophobic.
That was bad.
Moving around.
But the quality of presentations and the presentations, I thought overall were very good. So that was great. I don't know if you guys have anything to add.
Well, I went just for the day and I no reimbursable expenses for me technically didn't go. So
I have very few because we had the tickets for the dinner one night and then we went out to dinner the next night and Lynn already grabbed up that bill.
No,
so.
The mask actually let me go the day for free, so that was nice of them. I went to a couple, the one, it's funny, that I went to the one about food service and about how to keep your food service from whatever, because
going under?
Yeah, from going under, and that was interesting in that...
it was basically marketing.
The corporate, the Marriott,
Sodexo
people were there. Yeah. With all kinds of different
in jails.
And I was kind of astonished that that's who was giving the seminar, basically. But it was a few superintendents that were trying to, that had, and nobody, I actually raised my, I talk in all those things, of course, but I say, you know, we sort of have a thing where we have cooks that are really well known throughout the town, and like kids go to our school and then they get married and use their elementary school cooks to cater their wedding. That's the town that I live in. And nobody, you know, the idea
nobody of, could top
the
that
idea of actually making food that's that you start from a premise of making food that's just good to eat is like everybody was like, wow, what a great idea, you know, and just like they get so into the numbers and you know.
I almost went to that one, and then I saw the bottom because it had a whole blur about like nutrition. And then I remember Sodexo from because they were at my college cafeteria, and I was like, I don't know if I'm gonna go to that one. So I went to the other one with Elaine.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah. And then I went to the super evaluating the superintendent.
I stirred that one up too.
And
didn't
oh
you?
My goodness, do we do it differently? And those poor superintendents that are having school committees that listen to those directions, and just. That was just what they're recommending, the superintendent evaluation subcommittee that meet with the superintendent weekly and attend every high-level administrative meeting. Mm-hmm.
Those people have too much time
on
their hands.
They're making a lot of money, those superintendents.
Are you out of your mind? And it's like, well, you know, you want to create this relationship of trust where the, like, yeah, I'm sorry. Trust means do your job and let me know if there's a problem, you know? To an extent, it doesn't mean like I have to be there.
Micromanage you.
Yeah, oh my God.
You can come see me at my office anytime. Anytime you want, you can ask me anything.
That was what they were actually, and it, and I just say, we don't do any of that, and you're all crazy if you do that. That's just, you can't have a good relationship with your superintendent if you have to do that.
You know, the other very positive thing was the lunch, which I was like, oh God, this is going to be like, you know, whatever. I was just, you know, sometimes you're just not into that social, like, whatever, after you're in a conference all day. But I sat with a bunch of strangers, and it was very cool, because they were some... A variety of towns, and one town had seven towns or something. I mean, it was worse than ours. Like, I thought we were the worst, and that's, like, kind of near 495 corridor there. And then one was, like, near Worcester, and then I forget where the other people were from. But the near Worcester guy, he said they negotiate their school contracts with no lawyers.
I heard that.
I was like, I think we could try that, because I sometimes think that you both get your lawyer and then the lawyers are like doing this dance and whatever, and it's like really, there aren't usually that huge things for us that we could at least start the conversation with just the two of us.
You know what? My point was the same. I agree with that. But my point is that the result that we obtained would have been the same without the lawyers.
Without paying lawyers.
And so that was my thing. That as someone who was just, you know, right there, the lawyer was just like someone in both instances that we just said, shut up, we're doing this. And, you know, and because that's the way it has to be.
The last time I was on negotiations, our lawyer was very seasoned and he was good. He was not like wasting time. He wasn't making a ton of money on this. He was good. But the lawyer on the other side, on the union side, was brand new, I think, to this kind of stuff, and just seemed like it just made it take so much longer. And then I didn't do negotiations this year, but this past time. But I don't know how it was with the lawyers, but I was just like...
We do it early. In the grand scheme of the state, in our country, we do it early in the calendar year.
Right.
And so when we sat down, we're one of the very first ones in the state, and the union rep is getting pressure because there's a few key points that they want, like statewide, that they want to break out, and, you know, we're the first one in the area that's sitting down. And so, like, there was like this, they brought so much more aggravation to the process because they were under these, like, bigger, they were thinking of a bigger statewide scheme when all we wanted to do was do our little deal.
And I don't know that it costs us that much. I mean, I have no idea what the legal fees on both sides are and all that, but I can imagine we could use the money elsewhere, and why not try it?
Because they did keep us from violating the law on several occasions. Well, that is true. I mean, you want to have one on at least phone, like, standby for sure, and run everything by, like, as you're doing it, because there was a couple times when we, like, thought up of a great shortcut, and they're like, no, you can't do it. He was like, you can't do that. That's illegal.
All right. Well, that was one thing I learned over
But
lunch.
Other than that, I just remember, and actually, I only remember one instance of that happening.
Yeah.
And
that was cool, talking to other committees and, like, the kind of stuff they do or they face or whatever, so
It's great to hear other perspectives.
Yeah.
You know, every time I hear another perspective from somewhere else, Kristen and I are talking about that because we're both so new to the district, we just want to pinch ourselves because we're just so lucky to be here.
Yeah.
This is, you know, just such a little slice, you know, of heaven somewhere, I don't know. I always say a bad day here is better than a good day anywhere else.
Well, I don't know if you talked to the Holyoke superintendent at all, but there was a Holyoke school committee member there, and I've seen her before because now I'm working in Holyoke. So, but, you know, just makes you even more thankful, you know,
because
they're in receivership, so it's even more of a problem. But anyway, I thought it was very worthwhile. I don't know what you thought, but I just thought it was, you know, I would go again because it was like, it was useful,
good.
You know? So anyway, thank you for sponsoring us.
I like the idea that came up for next year to do like an Airbnb, like, in the house or
that
something.
That would be fun.
And we should be able to save money that way and make that, we would definitely save money that way.
Yeah. Alrighty. Other reports? The collaborative, have you hooked up with them yet?
I haven't yet.
Okay.
I missed the last meeting and I have to.
Okay. Are you on the email chain yet?
I'm not on the email chain.
Okay. I can tell Anne. I should tell. I keep getting emails, so I'll tell her I'm off.
You're
on.
Yeah.
Okay. Principal.
Oh, great. Okay. So I have a report here for you that. Just quickly go through and then some MCAS data that I want to share with you. So the first page, MCAS will review in a minute. Student enrollment, no changes during the month of October. We actually had a new preschooler come in, but that'll be in the next report. Classroom happenings, I just like to give you a little blurbs, and I attached a newsletter that has different happenings in the classroom. The box, has begun with Miss. Box has begun with Mrs. M. Box. That's what I wrote. I apologize. guys. Oh, no, right, Mrs. M, period. Boxes and before school.
Oh, there you go.
Okay, activity for elementary. Wow, the kids love that. This is all new to me, but the kids love that. I don't know if I shared this with you, but our students were given the opportunity to name the new fire truck coming to the fire department this spring. And students submitted names. Oh, they were just precious, some of the names that we got. And so they're going to pick a name from our school, and that's what they're going to name the truck. And the student winner gets to choose three friends and the teacher, and they're going to go for a ride.
That's cool.
Fire truck, yeah. Really, kids really got into that. We had a nice turnout for our kindergarten breakfast brunch on October 20th. We gave families ways to support literacy skills. Our community, Conway Community Work Day, we had about seven families. Megan Gump started the ball rolling on this. But we were a small but mighty crew, and we got a lot of work done. We did the whole front garden, which was great.
It was kind of a yucky day.
It was a yucky day,
because I was headed out to a horse show for Claire.
Some
and so,
yeah. Kids came and some families, and we'll have another one in the spring. Greenfield Savings Bank has been really great to us in terms of field trips and coming and doing things with the kids. And we're talking about maybe getting a banking program in our upper grades where kids who might want to open little accounts, $5, and have a little passport. So they've been a real great partner for us. Preschool apple picking, they were apple picking. That little preschool.
They are so cute.
They are adorable. They're like 3 years old. They're just babies. I'm like obsessed with the preschool.
So
you just go in and they're so cute.
A welcome retreat from the ails of the world, that's for sure.
There's one that looks like a Campbell kid. You know those little Campbell kids?
I know them well.
Yeah.
It's so funny.
They're selling things on television.
They're 3 years old and three of them were fighting about who's going to be the leader. And I'm thinking, how did they've only been alive for 3 years, how do they even know about who's going to be the leader? So cute. Our school is joining in with Monty's March, Monty from the River. We're going to be marching around our school at 11 o'clock on November 22nd. We've also collected food and change, and the recorder is going to come and do a little article on us for that day. And then we have some staff that they're going to actually walk from Yankee Candle to Greenfield at the end of the day. So the kids are really excited about that, which is great. And then our professional development with Mike Anderson has really been going great. We were asked to create a team of teachers. I'm not even sure if I have it on my list to share with you, to be peer coaches and work with Mike Anderson when he came. And I'm really happy to report that our team consists of every single classroom teacher in the building.
That's
so they've really
cool.
jumped down 100%, which is really great. I'm really excited about that.
That's awesome.
Then on the next page, we have our MCAS update. One thing I want to point out is that somewhere along the way, the district adopted the NWEA test. And I've been in districts where you have this test that you give a couple times a year. And then you look at it and you try to match it up with MCAS results, and they're so far off that it's not really helpful for planning along the way. Well, I'm going to tell you, this test is right on. The kids that did well on the NWEA, their scores were so consistent. So what I'm saying is that this test costs money, but it really helps with instruction because it really gives us a good thermometer in terms of where the kids are. So I did a little chart for
what
you.
What is the NWEA?
That's the Northwest Educational
Assessment. Yes.
And
it's a computerized
the
test.
The test is called MAPS, Measures of Academic Progress.
Yeah.
And it's standardized across the entire country.
That's
and
what...
I think Sarah was huge in bringing that in, wasn't she?
Is that the one that's standardized across the world?
Yeah, I don't know about the world, but I know that it's all over the country. I mean, I've never worked in a district that didn't have it. Everybody has it. It's easy. It's quick, and it's pretty valid. It is pretty substantial,
and it's computerized, which is what MCAS is going to.
Great.
So I made this chart
so that you could see where we are, where the district is, and where the state is. Mm-hmm. And as you can see, we're
doing pretty well.
Proudly, yeah, mm-hmm. above, right.
That little dip in fourth grade has been our little rhythm.
Fourth
here.
Grade test is so different.
It's so different. We've been consistent in that for as long as I can remember.
The state. But then look at fifth
across
grade.
The state.
Yeah, we're fourth graders last year.
We've always been consistent in that.
Across the state.
That's always been our thing.
Yeah.
Like, for seriously.
Yeah. Really, across the state. Fifth grade. So, but I'll tell you, teachers are really jumping on board with the differentiation, and you know what's great is the teachers are working even harder. So sometimes you get a little cautious about sharing scores like this, you know, but not the staff. They're working even harder. And I'll tell you, I've been going in and doing observations. I know you know this, but you have many great teachers in this building. Really great. They know how to teach. They know how to relate to kids. They know how to interact with kids. I'm just blown away when I go into classrooms on a daily basis. It's really great.
They do seem to like their kids.
I love the kids, yeah. Really do.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you don't always see that.
Yeah.
You just don't. People get frustrated or burnt out or feel unsupported, and for various reasons and some good reasons, but they just, you don't feel that. There's a genuine love of kids in the building, you know. And the teachers really understand the developmental level, and then what we're asking them to do, and they really do a nice job of sort of marrying that. So what are we doing to prepare students for the next test? We're practicing the same type of test, computerized, same type of test questions, continuing with our fidelity to the standards and curriculum, building academic stamina. That's where we see fourth grade, that's a big shift. They have to have this huge bit of stamina that they're not quite ready for at 9 years old. We're really pushing the keyboarding without tears, which is great for life.
They
keyboarding
really need
is
that.
A great pushing that and continuing to build confidence. And then the last thing that I wanted to show you was, here's a breakdown of our school by grade level. Of course, this is last year, and subject area, and the types of questions and standards. And if you look at the very last column, it gives you a quick and dirty look of what I'm talking about. If we are above, again, the state differential in all areas, except we dip a little bit in sixth grade. But this is very, very helpful in knowing what we have to teach and what we need to improve on, and having conversations about what we need to improve on. Again, doing very, very well. So we're looking at, a lot of times you see schools with many minuses.
Mm-hmm.
But here we're looking at, okay, where are our lowest scores? What do we need to look at? And this is a nice report because it gives you exactly the standard that you need to, you know, that you're really not hitting well. So for example, on the first page, grade three, we might really look at where we got the two. That's still good, we're still above. But that's something we want to push up, and that's crafts and structure. So this has really helped us inform our teaching as well.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the reports are, yeah, but this one's a really good one, and I just thought I'd share this with you.
Mm-hmm.
Easy to read, easy to figure out. There's one that we really, the grade six math. I can't believe where our sixth graders are in math. I wish you could come and see the sixth grade math lesson. It's unbelievable. These kids
actually,
are unbelievable.
Just to be in that sixth grade classroom is amazing. I'm sorry. That day that I went on that field trip to Northampton was one of the great days of my life. Seriously.
Mm-hmm.
That was amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's like,
there again, a genuine love for kids. And, yeah.
Oh, and he takes his mission seriously to get them ready for middle school.
Yes,
and he does a darn good job.
He does. Yeah.
Darn good job.
And you know, I see these teachers push the kids to the next level, and these kids just rise to the challenge. They're just really, you know, and you forget kids will do that. When you push them positively and gently and do it the right way, they just move right along.
Yeah.
I'm just As Lynn said, I'm in.
Any questions on the principal's report? All righty. Superintendent's report.
Great report, thank you. So my report is number one, the Massachusetts Association of School Committees and the Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents had their annual joint conference. And I listed the committee members that were there. Conway was very well represented. And we had a wonderful time. There was many different things. I kind of wrote the ones I went to. I did not go to the superintendent evaluation one. But, you know, what can I tell you? But anyway, I actually went to the ones that really, really struck me as, from my perspective, what I really would have, information I could use. And I really found a lot. The practical strategies for supporting children with anxiety-related oppositional behaviors was incredibly interesting. And when we talk about oppositional kids, we don't generally think about the fact that they're suffering from anxiety. You know, mm-hmm. We think about, well, they can control their behavior, they're choosing not to because they're oppositional. But the anxiety that that is manifesting itself in just a different way, and how intrinsic these external motivators don't often work. It really, you know, we have to reach them inside, and essentially what it's about is people. It's they need the people. They don't need things. They don't need to collect stars so they can get a tchotchke. They really want
to connect.
And they just are not able to do it, and mm-hmm. something is in the way, and that's what it's about. And in my history being a guidance counselor or a school adjustment counselor, it just really spoke to me. And of course, that was standing room only, and I was actually standing. I mean, but it was wonderful. It was mm-hmm. huge, but it was wonderful. And the presenter, I have her name somewhere. She was great.
Oh.
She was just great. So anyway, moving on, because we've already talked about it. The dinners were wonderful. The company mm-hmm. was great. Mm-hmm. The weather was nice. I think you know I didn't go out much, but it worked out really well. So
I think it's worth the money.
Yeah,
you know, I really do. A lot of ideas and knowledge and whatever that I didn't.
This year they had 900 people going, and I don't think that they had planned for that many. They had quite a lot of people this year, and so they just didn't have the rooms that size.
Did you have a feedback form where you could tell?
I didn't see. I don't know if they sent something to us afterwards that I ignored, we really need to give that feedback, because, I mean, it's a fine space, but the rooms are not big enough.
I just didn't like seeing the charter school parking lot sign. Right next to the hotel, so that every time you went in and out of that place, all you saw was
they lost
charter
it's
school.
Okay. They
charter
lost.
School right here, and
they lost.
The Cape has, in fact, there were just little pockets on the Cape, and Martha's Vineyard and Nantucket that voted. They were the tiny pieces that voted for the charter school.
Yeah,
and I think that they are. I think that they're burdened with, you know, charter schools. Quite a bit on the Cape. I was talking to a superintendent yesterday, the new superintendent induction program that says, they got it tough over there.
Yeah.
You know, I think she told me they were losing like $2.4 million a year to charter schools.
Oh my God.
In her area. And I can't remember what her town is. I want to say Brewster, but I could be wrong. So
that sounds right.
Quite a loss.
Did you guys see the charter school right across from where we had dinner?
That's what I'm talking about. If I was gonna, I would
in
vote
Hyannis?
To move that conference just for that fact.
I thought you saw.
No, I liked every. You know, I was fine, but that's the one thing about it that just completely grated my nerves. Is
Well, they do have, and I guess you have that image of the Cape being all affluent people, but it's not.
No, especially off season.
And so those people take their kids and don't put them in public school, I guess. I don't know. Right. So anyway, We are moving, as Kristen alluded to, we are moving to the computerized MCAS 2, grades 3 to 6, actually up to grade 8, this spring. And it's, we chose this option to help us transition to the computerized test, and it will be held harmless. Our scores, they'll count, there are pieces of it that will count, like our, you know, like our amount of the attendance or whatever that piece is that counts, how many students took the test, I forget what it's called, mm-hmm. I can't think of it right now, but so the attendance piece and those kinds of things will count, but the scores will not count against us. But we are transitioning over so that the teachers can get a feel for the computerized test, the students can get a feel, we can introduce it, and this year we're doing the MAPS testing, computerized testing, not only last year they did it in the fall and the spring, and this year I asked that they do it in the winter as well, so that the kids again have that exercise of being on the computer. The MCAS 2 is going to be a little different. They're going to have to move, as they get older, move from screen to screen. So they'll have two or three different reading prompts, and they'll say, you know, they'll ask them to compare and contrast, so they'll go from finding one theme in a poem and one theme in a narrative and finding the same theme. So they'll have to move within screens and this kind of thing. So these skills, you know, it will help us understand more about what we're looking at. And I just want to talk a little bit about the Rural Schools Coalition. That is, it's been developed, it's a proposal to request the state to approve higher state aid for rural schools by increasing our Chapter 70 funding, our aid, from a flat formula used by all the schools in the country, in the state, to include tier allocations, tiered. And that's determined by tiers of declining enrollment and eligibility criteria and targeted aid. So we all know that small schools provide innumerable, you can't even count how many benefits, how much better it is for students, small schools, but the total cost of operating a small school is rising. It's expensive to mm-hmm. have a small school in your community, so it's a treasure. However, the state, the aid we get from the state is the same as an aid, as the aid they give to,
I know, it's crazy,
per student based on blah 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 that they would do in a very heavily populated urban school. So the flat rate isn't really fair. We're losing a lot of students in this area, the declining enrollment over the years, and yet the costs are going up. So this Rural Schools Coalition, which I've been going to the meetings and we're a part of, is putting together a proposal. They asked that we all go to our committees. The last meeting I was at, there were 15 superintendents from this area and Senator Stan Rosenberg. And so one of the things that Mike Bonacani, the superintendent that developed this, he developed it for his doctoral program, and he is the superintendent at Mohawk mm-hmm. Regional. He said, you know, go to your school committees and get support from them. And what I'm doing is I'm informing you and letting you know that we're looking at it. I'm not asking for support at this point because I'm not sure. I'm not sure what the impact really will be. I need to know more. If they have anything to say or do that would have any impact, will it impact our regional transportation? Will it impact some other way? Well, you know, we really have to know. I have to know a lot more. And we also need to know that the urban schools have a coalition and the suburban schools have a coalition and the rural schools have a coalition. So, you know, I don't know. Something about Chapter 70 needs to change. I don't know what.
Yeah.
So,
you know, an interesting one, when the education commissioner was here in the fall at Greenfield, they published his remarks or whatever, and he was asked about the funding formula.
Mm-hmm.
And What he said was that, he said, yeah, there are some inequities to rural schools with the current setup, but you're doing just as good a job as anyone else, and your student outcomes are just as good as anywhere else in the state.
So why bother?
So why give you more money?
So that's really...
But what about our taxpayers? And don't our kids deserve the best? Yeah, that doesn't...
Is it true? Are our student outcomes the same as Newton North and...
Well, clearly Conway.
Well, Conway is.
Better than any of...
Well, I mean, that's right. So it's like...
So they're saying, you know, the outcome, you're doing a great job with what you
have. Yeah, quit your bitching.
Wow.
I mean, that's basically what they're saying. You're doing a good job. Everything's fine. And I, you know...
I don't know.
That's the price we pay for living in heaven.
I guess
that's it.
So then we talked, I did want to talk a little bit about that meeting where the Senate President, the State Senate President, Sam Rosenberg, was at the last meeting, and he talked about the RISE Act. And the RISE Act is something he's been working on. It's the Reform, Innovation, and Success in Education Act. And what this is different than the Rural Schools Act, that chapter. So this act, part of the act would be, if we have children going to charter schools, that we would get a little bit more funding. So school choice, our students leave, we lose $5,000, we pay $5,000 for school choice. But if our students choose to go to a charter school and the tuition at the charter school is $14,000, the state's going to give us $5,000, but we've got to pay out $14,000. So that's the problem with charter schools. It's very costly. And so he's looking at maybe an additional $1,000 per student, or maybe, you know, to get more money for us. He was able to get it through the Senate. His committee was able to get it through the Senate, but not the House. And so they're going to reissue it and see if they can get the House coming this year to do it. But it's also, it's going to involve putting a little bit more accountability on the charter schools. For instance, my understanding is charter school teachers don't have to be certified.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I'm not sure the makeup of their school committees, if parents are on it or anything like that. From what I'm reading, you know, that the governance, a local school committee, you know, the governance of the school and the contracts, the policies, the board meetings, the disclosure is not this as rigorous as ours are. They don't have the same regulations that we must follow. So they're getting public school money, but they're not playing by the same rules that we're playing. So they want to kind of balance that out. And so those are the two things that we're just keeping our eyes on, mm-hmm. and hoping that, you know, we're fortunate here because we are a district where people choose to come, so we do get school choice.
Right.
It's a wonderful place. We have a great reputation. We're not really burdened by too many kids going to charter schools.
Mm-hmm.
When our kids go somewhere, they go to private school, and so that's no impact on us, but then we lose those students, and we want to keep our best and brightest with us. You know, we want to keep everyone with us. But so that's my report.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
No need for executive session. Anything else before we adjourn?
We had an awful, catastrophic national election since the last time we met, and I would just like to say that that was the worst thing that ever happened to me in my lifetime.
Okay.
So
we can talk about that later.
Let's go to the end.
Okay. Can I get a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.